anybody?
No, it's me.
Oh, hi. Who's me?
Leah.
Hi.
Hello.
I just put a wedge on the door outside because, you know, it's locked.
Oh, yeah.
I did that already.
Oh, you did that already?
I did it.
Oh, sorry.
And I'm wondering if that's okay, right?
I think that's okay.
Yeah. I think I should tell Terry, right? Or should I?
Probably.
Could you, you know, since Emma's back there, I don't want to get in her space. Could you tell her?
Hi.
Thank you. Because I just was going to say, is CJ here?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh,
yeah.
CJ, just put a wedge on the outer door.
Oh, great. Okay.
I mean, that's okay, right?
Yeah.
Well, they're
yeah.
Because we.
I mean, or should I text Tom to tell him to unlock it?
I can unlock it.
Oh, yeah. Okay, that's great.
Well, then there you go.
Okay, very good. You find all kinds of things.
Yeah.
There, can you turn your pack on? Emma, can you turn your pack on? You good?
Based on what she hears. And she uses the monologues verbatim from what the people she interviewed said. So these actors have chosen these characters out of a hat. So they had there was no casting involved. They just took what they got. And they created these characters. In some cases, they were able to see or hear actual recordings of the actual people. In most cases, we were able to see Anna Deavere Smith's interpretation. And she talks a lot about embodying the character and finding the character in the sound of the voice and and the tone of the voice. So what you will hear, we hope, is a shift in the voices of these actors just to embrace, while still remaining as authentic as possible to the character, the physical makeup of these characters. All of the questions she asked them were about death. So, and it's really not that difficult a topic, that sad a topic. So, and we've thrown in a couple of other things about death, which we hope you'll also enjoy. Part of the work we did was we spent a day at the Pig Iron School for Advanced Performance Training, and each of the actors worked with the students there to develop the character and the primal part of their characters by choosing an animal. So you could ask them afterwards what animal they were working on for each of these characters. Anna Deavere Smith believed very strongly and I believe strongly too, that you can better understand and be and feel and empathize and have compassion if you really crawl around in the shoes of another character, in the skin of another character, if you try to understand the world from their point of view. And that's the way to build people who can participate in democracy, as far as I'm concerned. So this exercise has been great, and it's been wonderful to watch these students. So you know, this is a classroom project. We've never done it full out as a production, so we're hoping all goes well, and feel that it definitely will. So, have I missed anything? We're actually filming it for Anna Deavere Smith. Yeah. She requested, I've been sort of like I've been stalking her for 20 years. And I first started doing these projects with a piece it's called Fires in the Mirror, which was in 1999. And so the drama classes have been working with Anna Deavere Smith type of works. We've done Studs Terkel, we've done Anna Deavere Smith, we sort of shifted around. So she is fully aware of the work that Friends Central does. She told our headmaster, who actually went up to her in a bar in New York, was unexpectedly found her there and said, "I'm from Friends Central," or "I'm the head of Friends Central School." And she said, evidently, "I love your school. I love what your school does with my plays. These are the ways." So that, yes, it felt amazing to hear that. So then, which prompted me to write to her and say, you'll meet with us in May. We're coming up to New York in May. So I'm a bit of a pest, but I have met her on a couple of occasions, and she's been great.
Will we have access to that video?
You will. Okay. You will. I'm not sure exactly what the copyright thing is, but I figure since she asked for it, we can send it to her and certainly make it available to families. I'm hoping the show is an hour, but I don't know. It won't be less than an hour, I don't think, but if it's more than an hour, it won't be too much more than an hour, so I can't say that much. And I try never to ask the students to do something I wouldn't do, so I have a little part in this in the beginning. And I'm really nervous, so. Did I miss anything? Yep. Okay. You guys ready? Before us, great death stands and holds our fate close within his quiet hands. When, with proud joy, we lift life's red wine to drink deep of its shining mystic cup, an ecstasy within our being leaps. Death bows his head and weeps. Yeah.
The uncertainty, the fear, the sadness, and so on, all that can be helped. So it will be the most difficult period of our life when we come to the end of our lives. It is not plausible to turn dying into a picnic. It will never happen. We are not built to assume with a smile the end of our lives. Some of us will, but most of us will not. No, not everybody has the same death. Some people have a very easy death, and some people have a very difficult death. And that should not surprise us, because some people have a very easy life, and some people have a very difficult life. Major stressors that happen to us before we face the end of our lives include adolescence, divorce, losses of our own families, losses of those who's near us, job losses, relocations. We have a trend to confront the end of our lives the way we have confronted those events. If we were depressed and took to the bed, we will probably do it again. If we were angry, we'll probably be angry. If we deny the whole thing, we will probably deny the whole thing. If we blame someone else, we will probably do it too. So, in our repertoire of coping, we are a bit predictable. And those of us who drink, will drink. And those of us who... So, in our way of dealing with a devastating problem and using the resources around us to cope, we are a bit more predictable than we would like to think. There are stories about people selling all their belongings and getting a sailboat and going out to the Caribbean. But it's not usually what happens. Usually we buy in the same supermarket, we do the same routine, and then we die. Yes, deep existential sadness.
Well, if you mention the word mortality, the first place that I'm automatically going to think of in Schubert's quintet is the adagio movement, the slow movement. Now, Schubert lived in a city that has always been death-haunted. Vienna is the only city that I know of that has a funeral museum, a museum for funeral coaches, and all of that funerary pomp, which was not only expended on the Habsburg monarchs, but also on ordinary citizens who would compete with one another. other for magnificent burials of the dead. So Schubert has always been, I think, very attentive to death because he was Viennese. Now, sometime in late 1822 or early 1823, we don't know when, how, we know nothing about the circumstances, but he contracted syphilis, which was the AIDS of the 19th century. So everything that he composed from late 1822 on is under the sign of death. There's actually one very famous piece from September 1828, the Adantino movement of the A major piano sonata. It starts in a relative minor, very wistful, like the Adagio movement of the string quintet, after which there's only what I can call a gigantic temper tantrum, music that is unlike any other from the 19th century. It's like a cataclysm exploding or a Vesuvius happening. After which that cataclysm dies off and you return to a repetition of the beginning of the movement. I think facing death the way Schubert faced it in his final year requires an adamantine exercise of will to insist on the creation of unmistakable beauty. And to insist on the creation of songs and works that are not about bitterness or cynicism or resentment. Schubert died in November 19th, 1828, just shy of his 32nd birthday. And in that brief lifetime, he composed over 1,000 works of music. I don't think I would have liked Schubert. I would have loved him. He's not Shakespeare.
If we must die, let it not be like hogs hunted and penned in some inglorious spot, while round us bark the mad and hungry dogs, making their mock at our accursed lot. If we must die, oh, let us nobly die, so that our precious blood may not be shed in vain. Then even the monsters we defy shall be constrained to honor us, though dead. O kinsmen, we must meet the common foe. Though far outnumbered, let us show us brave, and for their 1,000 blows deal one death blow. What though before us lies the open grave? Like men, we'll face the murderous, cowardly pack, pressed to the wall, dying, but fighting back. Claude McKay.
Some bright morning when this life is over,
I'll fly away in the morning when
go to the hospital. So, you know, he got on the phone and he called the hospital. You know, a civilian can only go to a military hospital when it's like a life or death situation. So, I guess it was a life or death situation. You know, when you write a war and you do good and you write them, you just feel like there ain't nothing in this world that could probably, you know, beat you up or anything like that. Cause you just feel like life couldn't be better. Like that this is what life's supposed to be. You know, well, if you think about it, you shouldn't be able to stay on the back of the wall that's trying to buck you off, you know? Because we weigh 150 pounds, you know? And they weigh 2,000 pounds, you know? And you just feel like a king at the moment, you know? Yeah, you know. When I'm not rodeoing no more, I'll just be alright, you know? I mean, I got my ranch and my cows and all that, but I don't want to think about that. There will just be an empty space in me, you know? A big old empty space. It's probably an even bigger empty space than when my brother died. Toughness was in West Jordan, Utah, and I had this bull shove my face, like, right through the metal sheets. I mean, my nose. Well, they shoved these two rods up my nose, and it just straightens my nose all up. Felt like they were shoving it clear through my brains, and it was gonna come out the top of my head. And everyone that saw it, they said it was gonna kill me, and that didn't even knock me out. So, I guess that was toughness. But once they did that, I could finally breathe, and I hadn't been able to breathe through my nose since I had broken when I was in, like, high school rodeo. About death.
Well, the first thing I think about death is that there's ways I'd like to die. Like, I'd like to... Well, I mean, one time I was on fire, because I did a fire dance with my girlfriend. I accidentally caught on fire, and I thought, I don't think I'd like to burn to death. I actually caught on fire. You sterno. Crazy. This was a couple years ago, and I wanted to do something really special for her 40th birthday, for Lara, yeah. So I thought of Blaze Away, where basically I'd start a fire, then land on it to put it out. So I used the Melissa Etheridge song. Cause I'm the only one who walk across a fire for you. So I made Lara stand there, and I stood here, and my dancers were lighting fire, and I made her walk towards me, and she had no idea what was going on, and there were like 100 people at the party. So I flew in, you fly, you go into a crouch, and at this certain moment, you go into a flying horizontal X. And I made the fire as big as this torso part so I could smush it, but big enough that you could see it, but not so big that it went outside my body. So I landed. But unbeknownst to me, I'd been rehearsing, and I had some sterno left on my torso. So when I was like, whoop, I look under, and I go, oh, I'm on fire. And, ooh, I smushed it, and oh, that's not gonna happen. So I stood up, and I was literally on fire. I was going like this, and like that, and oh my God, that's the fastest phenomenon I'd ever seen. I've never seen anything move that fast or be that fast. So I was like, okay, and just the seconds were stretched, and everybody was looking at me, but nobody did anything. And I know, isn't it like freaking crazy? Like, everybody's looking, but nobody did anything. And even my friend was continuing to take pictures. Didn't need them, my friend. So I was like, okay. I was going like this and like that. I was like, that's not gonna happen. This sternum is gonna burn, because it went through my pants. It's gonna burn till it's gone, right? But it was really one of like the most profound experiences, because for a few days after that, I would see complete strangers and think, well, you know, I caught on fire. I was on fire. So it's that sort of thing. But there's other ways I'd like to die. I'd like to fall along the ways and crash, or fall down a flight of stairs. I think
want to know how the lights are going to go out in a particular way. It's sad, isn't it?
Death!
Be not proud!
No song have called thee mighty and dreadful!
For thou art not so.
For those whom thou think'st thou dost overthrow.
Die not, poor death.
Nor yet canst thou kill me.
From rest and sleep.
Which with thy pictures be.
Much pleasure.
And from thee much more must flow.
And soonest our best men with thee do go.
Rest of their bones
and soul's delivery. Thou art slave to fate.
Chance.
Kings.
And desperate men.
And dost with poison.
War.
And sickness dwell.
And poppy or charms can make us sleep as well.
And better than thy stroke.
Why smokest thou then?
One shall sleep past.
We wake
eternally.
And death shall be no more.
Death.
Thou shalt die.
John Donne.
Tommy Morrison. He was our generation's, this generation's version of the great white hope. And I was Tommy's tune-up match before the big fight. Tommy was sharp, put asses in seats. And I was just this good amateur. Had, call it whiskers. So HBO had a free day, and they wanted to fill it just to keep Tommy sharp. The only thing running through my mind is, ain't no white boy beating me. Not in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Not in his own backyard. Sorry, one second. It's the wife. Hey, last name, baby. I'm with Anna, okay? Yeah. Can I call you back? Thanks. Bye. My first fight? Oh, my last one. The Herbie Highland. I hardly remember it at all. The last thing I remember is... Are you familiar with London at all? No. Well, I was in a hotel in London with my entourage, just eating pasta, and then the next thing I know, I see this light. Not just one light, but a series of lights. And I'm thinking, fuck, I'm knocked out. Because when boxers see lights, we figure shit, we've been knocked out. Because lights are typically on the ceiling. So if I'm looking up at the ceiling, then I must be on my back. Fuck! I tried to get up, but these elbows, like hands, they pushed me back down. Ease me back down. And then the series of lights, it just turns into one light. Fuck! Am I fucking high? Am I bugging out? Turns out it was my doctor's pen light. My neurosurgeon was shining a pen light in my eyes. And he turns to me and says, Mike, you all right? Know where you are? Yeah, I'm in London. Remember what happened? No. You got knocked out. It's pretty bad. We're behind. 7 rounds. And then he just looks me in the eye and says, you can't fight anymore. I think I damn near started crying. You know, fighting, it always conflicted me, but there was still something about it. It's how I define myself, you know? I'd walk into a room when I was a champ, and people, they would scream, woo, that's Michael Beck, world heavyweight champion, knocked out Tommy Morrison, first. that they're driven to. Tell a downhill skier, tell an Austrian gold medalist downhill Olympic skier. Oh no, you don't want to take a little EPO? You might hurt yourself. Are you kidding me? They don't understand it. It's patronizing. Some guy told me that the Greeks would have ground up rhinoceros skin and eaten it if they thought it could make them run any faster or do anything better. Reminds me of this great documentary I saw about the Stephen Hawking's book. What was the name of the book? What the hell is the name of that book? I'm not remembering. It was this great documentary, and there was this great little part about just the energy that's released when a cup breaks. You know, I drop this cup, and it breaks. And there was this great little illustration of just the energy that's released, and you know, the cup has to fall, and it has to hit the ground, and the energy, and you can't pick it up from the ground again. Once it's down, it can't pick itself back up and put itself back together. That's not how matter works. Well, those are athletes. Athletes are the cup hitting the floor and smashing. I mean, to me, an athlete has two deaths. Bill Bradley said that one time, you know? So when you have an athlete who retires, when someone like Lance reaches the end of their road, it's a form of death. It certainly is a form of surrender. That's why they have such a hard time with it. And they don't want that incarnation of themselves to die. We don't want that incarnation of them to die. People want perfection from athletes, and they want moral perfection. And we as spectators want this vision of them as sort of perfect for all time, you know, as immortal in our eyes. And then someone like Lance comes along and people go, well, I don't want to remember him as anything less than great. Or, you know, why is he tainting his legacy? All that nonsense, you know. But I think it's because people want I think people want this kind of timeless perfection. It makes them uncomfortable to watch athletes grow old. I mean, athletes are us.
Why don't we want to see women age? Why is everybody so terrified to see women age? Why is everybody so terrified to see aging, period, in this culture? Why do we put old people in places and remove them from sight? Because they remind us, I'm going to die. And I think that's true with the body. If you have the perfect body, and tits, and ass, it moves you forward with men. It moves you forward with women. It moves you forward in jobs. And I think fitting yourself into this idea has become what a lot of people are spending a lot of time doing. You know, just energy, money, time. But it's also connected to dying. Because you see, in this culture, people don't really die. We're all immortal here. Death isn't among us. Death isn't with us. And I think it's all part of this. Like, the reason I believe in sex. Like, above everything else, why I believe sex is so important is because it's where you see your body in relation to another body. It's genius, sex. It's where it becomes spiritual. It's where it becomes intellectual and where the body starts morphing into all of these other amazing things. And I think girls get cut off from this at a very young age, and it's what directs them to start manipulating their body. It's almost like anorexia is this very asexual thing. Those girls aren't having sex, they're fixing their body. There's fixing your body, and there's sex. And so you start shutting down the person and limiting the person until you disappear the person. You know, you can't think much when all you've eaten is a raisin a day. You know, you need to have food in order to have a thought. And I don't think that's accidental one bit. I think it comes from capitalism. How do you get people hooked on a disappearing idea of themselves. The people I'm most drawn to in life are the women who, you know, I have this game I like to play, who lives in their vagina? And I'll walk around and I'll look at people and I'll go, in her vagina, not in her vagina, in her vagina. Like Tina Turner. You know, you can just watch her in her career where she literally lands in her vagina. That is what it looks like. That is what it's like to be fully incarnated in your body.
She dated a fella who was evidently infected, and she didn't know, and she got the virus. I mean, it wasn't intravenously, it was sexually. She had gotten very sick. So I had this very bad experience with doctors and nurses when my daughter went for dialysis here in New Haven. So they hooked her up onto this machine, and the nurse went down the other end of the hallway, left her in this room with the machine, and I was with her. And then something happened. The thing came loose, and the blood was just coming out. It was in her hair, it was on her face, it was all over, and I was looking for the nurse, and I couldn't find a nurse, and I looked in rooms, I was calling for help, and nobody At least I say about 3 to 5 minutes. It was a long time. And the blood was just coming out and coming out. And it was in her hair, it was on her face, it was on her jeans, it had gotten on me. It was squirting all over the place. It was like a nightmare. And finally, the doctor and nurses came in and they unhook her from this machine and wrap her sheet around her on top of all the blood. And then they said to me, I can bring her back another day. And you know, she was soaking wet with blood, and I can bring her back another day. They can do the dialysis or whatever they're gonna do if I bring her back another day. And I said, okay. They just wrapped a sheet around my daughter. A sheet around my daughter. And at the time, we didn't have a car. Well, we had a car, but it was in the shop, so we had to wrap her up in a sheet with all the blood still coming out and whatnot, and put her on a taxi and take her home. So I had like a very bad experience with nurses and doctors, and how could they just do this? Well, I'm not saying this because it was my daughter, but she was a very smart girl. She died. So I'm not having any dialysis.
The biggest asshole I ever met during my training experience? God, there are so many. God, it's tough. I know. Shit, I can't remember his name, but he was such an asshole. Like, well, I always thought that we had this tremendous opportunity to see, in some sense, what it would be like to be poor, and to open our hearts and our minds to the fantastic people coming into the hospital. Privileged students from all over, they come in and they train at Charity Hospital, and they come in with their own baggage about what the charity population is. That's sort of a common phrase, our population, meaning the people we take care of and are distancing ourselves from them. Because well, people come in with their own racism and their own classism. This guy. One night we were on call and a young woman came in with pelvic inflammatory disease, and she was 13, and he was giving her a pelvic exam, and she was in so much pain, crying out, and he said, and I want to get this right, he said, "What's your problem? Don't tell me you haven't had something bigger than these two fingers up there if you got this to begin with." I was a third year medical student and he was a second year resident, so he was many levels above me. And then he said this typical line, "Oh, you wait and see when you're in my spot," which is just, what, once you've been through this so many times, once you've seen so many 12-year-olds with pelvic inflammatory disease, you what? You become an asshole? Because I have to say, the one thing that I always loved about being at Charity Hospital was that I always felt like there's no reason that I can't provide the absolute top-of-the-line best medical care. And I think that was very difficult when things deteriorated in the hospital during Hurricane Katrina. One of my patients said to me, and he was, like almost all my patients, very immobile. And you know, he was just lying in bed, and it's 106 degrees, there are no lights, and we're reduced to feeding people very small portions, and I think we were all just so exhausted. And I remember he said to me, Dr. K, have all the patients in the private hospitals gotten out? And I said, yeah, you know what, they have. And he said, do you think they're going to come get us today? And it had already been 5 days, and I said, you know, I look out and I see the sun is setting, and they've given us a lot of promises about coming to get us, but the sun is setting, so I think we're gonna be here another night. And I think we have to be prepared for that. And he said, do you think they're going to come for us eventually? And I said, you know what? I really don't know. And, you know, I'm privileged. And that was the first time I've ever been totally abandoned by my government. And something that people said to me early on was, they're not going to come get us. We're going to be stuck here. And here I am coming from this privileged position in the world. What do you mean they're not going to come get us? That feeling of abandonment, for me, it was all new. Being abandoned, it was all new. But for so many people, it was just another thing. It was just another example of how they were abandoned. But people went about their business. Every nurse on the floor, they never stopped working. They never missed a vital sign. They never missed a urine output. They never missed a trick. And there was this heavy sense of resignation. But that feeling, that facade of, well, you're at Charity Hospital, but don't worry, you're going to get the best possible care. It was like that was gone, because we're going to give you the best possible care, but we can't make the government and FEMA come get us.
You know, we're sort of left there at the end. The medical people have departed. They're not going to stick around. They, in fact, I was a very young man. I had a parishioner dying in the hospital. And when it was clear that the person was going to go away, no more could be done, the doctor said, we'll leave him to you now, to the clergy. And part of me was really annoyed at that. But frankly, I was glad that they were gone. There was a recognition, almost, that they had finished their function, but we hadn't finished ours. And so off they go. But my work is to make the movement from this life to the next as graceful and as easy as possible. Leaving is not done like that. It is it's like that. Off you go. At least that's what they tell me, anyway. And doctors resent the notion that they're leaving in defeat, because death is a defeat for them. And so they have to go and save somebody else. At the grave, I read the prayer book office, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. This is it, folks. I don't say it quite like that, but I always insist that you see the box go down into the ground. You need to know that this is a form of finality, and we will not meet again under these circumstances. So, cherish the moment. I say, cherish the moment. And so, it means taking measure of the days you have left. Taking death seriously. And my job is then to urge them to come back. I don't want you to leave here full of sorrow and sadness. I want you to know that this is the place where you come to recall life in whatever fashion you have of the person that we sent off today. I say, come back. Bring flowers. Remember your loved ones.
Around Europe.
death comes, like a hungry bear in autumn.
When death comes and takes all the bright coins from this purse to buy me and snaps the purse shut.
When death comes.
Like the mesopox.
When death comes.
Like an iceberg between the shoulder blades.
I want to step through the door full of curiosity, wondering, what is it going to be like, that cottage of darkness?
And therefore, I look upon everything as a brotherhood or a sisterhood.
And I look upon time as no more than an idea.
And I consider eternity to be another possibility.
And I think of each person as a flower, as common as a field daisy, and as singular.
And each name a comfortable music in the mouth, tending, as all music does, towards silence.
And each body a lion of courage.
And something precious to the earth.
When it's over. I want to say all my life.
I was a bride married to amazement.
And I was the bridegroom.
Taking the world into my arms.
When it's over. I don't want to wonder.
If I made my life something particular and real.
I don't want to find myself sighing, frightened, or full of argument.
I don't want to have ended up simply visiting.